Enough time to relax. Okay, so the chapter on Hull, you have to study the risk management disasters, the chapter from Hull. This is chapter 37. Okay, you can see that. Everyone can see it, chapter 37. So you can just read this stuff. And it's very light stuff, but you need to be familiar with all these events. Okay, so we'll just leave this aside for the moment. Now, this is your own, your homework kind of stuff that you have to do. So our next topic is decision problems that we have to deal with. Most of these over here. So now we're going to look at, we are already familiar with the decision problems in managing a speculative book, which you have done in your last two projects, right? So we know what those decision problems are. Now we are going to take up those same, the same decision problems, and we're going to see how they change, or do they change, or do the solutions change in any way when you are dealing now with a passive risk book, like what you're dealing with here, not here. Here you have a passive risk book. Now when you're dealing with this passive risk book and running a hedge portfolio, right, to minimize your total losses, underlying position losses and hedge position losses, when you're managing this passive risk book, do the solutions to the decision problems change in any way when you're running a hedge book versus a spec book? A spec book is what you have run before, right? We saw the decisions, we have listed the same decisions, all right? Now we're going to just discuss them briefly, right? So the first three, which we have talked about here, this actually is a carryover, this is a holdover from the speculative book discussion, where you have DP 1, 2, 3 asset classes, markets, instrument, usually solved by a direct, indirect investor mandate. Why do I say indirect? Is either the investor himself says that I'm giving you money, like I did for you with the two projects. I gave you money and I told you in one case you're only allowed to trade NSE stocks, right? And in another case, I told you that you're only allowed to trade US equity options, right? So that's an example of the direct investor mandate, where the person who's giving you the money to manage tells you what asset classes, what markets, and what instruments you can invest in. This is clear. When I tell you to invest in US equity options and I give you a very tight list, a fairly short list of stocks that you could trade options on. So that's an example of, those are the markets. So market for Amazon common stock, market for Facebook, market for all the Oracle and all these other stocks that I named. So those are the markets, and those markets, you're only allowed to trade options on those common stocks, not even allowed to trade the actual common stock. So that's an example. So that's the instrument, right? So you have market and instrument, and because of that, you can see the asset classes. What? So the asset classes? Yeah, so my asset class is equities, right? So the question was basically, in the decision problems, you always have to decide when you're starting from a blank slate. If you look at our overall matrix of asset classes, markets, and instruments, so you always have the question of, if there is no direction from anyone, you have to take that decision as to what asset classes am I going to, if you're managing a fund, right? And you start from a blank slate and the investor doesn't tell you anything, or the investor tells you that you can do whatever you want. In that case, you still have to decide it. Just because you've been given the permission to do whatever you want doesn't mean that you'll do everything. You may decide to focus on a few asset classes, right? So the point is that then you still have to take those. So therefore, these are decision problems, asset class, market, instrument. And so in this case, when I've forced you to trade certain specific US equity options on certain specific stocks. So the stocks are the markets, the instrument is options. And because it's equity options, the asset class is equities. Is everyone clear? Yeah. That these are the decision problems, and this is how it gets solved by a direct investor mandate. Okay. And the other type of mandate is, sometimes if you have, like for instance, if you see now we have started REITs in India, you know what a REIT is? Real Estate Investment Trust. You haven't heard this term? Okay, so this stuff has actually been there for, you can read up, actually this, you should have heard of it, because in my miscellaneous lectures, there is a link to, there's actually a discussion about MBA students, what kind of markets they should follow, tracking markets for MBA students. One of the videos in my miscellaneous lectures, under miscellaneous lectures, you'll see there's a discussion, and there's a link And there's a discussion. I've given some links under the YouTube video for tracking real estate. When we discuss real estate, okay, so there are various ways to invest in real estate. One of them is basically this idea. So you should go and read that, because we did not have a detailed discussion of real estate because it is not as important as currencies, commodities, equities, and debt. Not that big an asset class, but it's become fairly important now, especially after the financial crisis. So a REIT is a real estate investment trust. Okay. Please go to the links I've given you. Don't just go arbitrarily on the internet and search for REITs. The links I've given in my under miscellaneous lectures, the playlist, there is a lecture on tracking markets, and you'll see one of the lectures has MBA student guidance, etc. One of the lectures has a bunch of links for real estate, how real estate can be traded. So REIT is just like a ETF kind of structure. Okay, it's just an ETF kind of, it's like a mutual fund essentially, right? So that fund, you invest in that fund, it's like a mutual fund or like an ETF. You invest in it, and the money that you put in, that money goes into actual physical real estate investments, right? It goes into actual, so that money, whatever money you put in, let's say the total corpus comes out to be $1 billion. People, you launch a REIT, okay? And then people subscribe to it, just like an IPO, right? And then all the money, that suppose you raise $1 billion. Now, what are you going to do with $1 billion? Instead of starting a company, you're going to take that $1 billion and invest it in various real estate projects. Right, so you'll take a mall, maybe you'll go invest, if somebody's buying out PVR Saket, you'll go and invest in that buyout. Okay, so that money goes directly into actual physical real estate investments, or maybe you construct a new mall somewhere, right? So it can go into commercial, it can go into residential, right? All these things. So that's what a REIT is, a real estate investment trust. It's just like a mutual fund. You put it in, put the money in, and the money eventually goes directly to a physical investment in a real estate, some kind of real estate, I guess shopping mall, apartment complex, whatever. Okay, and then the rule, the condition that they have, at least in the US, I haven't seen the conditions for India. We just had the first REIT in India just about less than a year ago. It was launched by Blackstone, which is a private equity group from the US. So the US, they've had it from the 1960s. Okay, and this, one of the conditions in the US is that the REIT has to pay out all its income in the form of dividends. That is a condition for getting the right to list as a REIT. So all the money has to be paid out in dividends. All the profit in a particular year is a full payout in the form of dividends. Okay, so I'll just write this for the US. I don't know the conditions for India. I'll write PAT, okay? Profit after tax must be paid out as dividends, okay? So this is, here you have a classic case for applying the Gordon growth model. Okay, I mean, a very neat case, because all the income comes in, there is no question of dividend payout ratio. Payout ratio is 100%. Okay, so this is a condition that is there in the US. So why did I come to REITs? Why did I come to this discussion? Anyway, so these are all decisions that you make. So direct investor mandate, you've understood now. Okay, and indirect investor mandate is where you yourself, as the money manager, you decide that I've got a special expertise in real estate or residential real estate. I'm so smart that I can figure out which residential real estate projects in the country are going to do well, and I will therefore invest in those projects, and I will launch a REIT, which will be some residential real estate residential REIT. And therefore, here what you're doing is, you are actually, this is an indirect investor mandate, because you're actually, the money manager himself is deciding that this is my expertise. So I will go and raise money for the narrowly focused purpose of investing in residential real estate. Are you following the logic? Here the investor is not forcing you to do anything, but you yourself are deciding that I don't know anything about currencies, I don't know anything about commodities, but I know residential real estate very well. So let me raise money to invest in residential real estate. Here is an example of you're choosing the asset class yourself. You could have gone into anything, but you're choosing it yourself. So you're going to the investor and raising money for the narrowly focused purpose of investing in residential real estate. Is this clear? Are you following what I'm saying here? So why did I say indirect investor mandate? That's what I mean by that. That sometimes you can have, you can see this, all this unrest must be good for the country, because the Nifty keeps going up. So I don't know what. So anyway, so So what I was saying is that this is the indirect investor mandate. So asset classes, markets, and instrument, this decision can be solved in one of the two ways, one of these two ways, direct or indirect investor mandate. Everyone's clear about this? We've already done this before, we're just recapping. Right, now we are going into the second point. Now let's discuss for this, because in our case, there's a question, right? Right, so question number three, right? Are you able to follow this case? Are you finding it, is it something that is appealing? Because it's actually a case which I've written, so it's not a like a formal case, like a Harvard case or something. It's just a case that I've written. But is it making sense to you guys?
Yes,
as students?
Yes, sir.
Right, because this is just a trial in the sense, right? And then that sense, because I've written this to basically, the idea behind this case is to bring out all the elements of corporate treasury risk management, all the elements of managing a passive risk book. When you have a passive risk book, how do you manage, what kind of decision problems do you face when running the hedge portfolio, right? Okay, this is what. So now we're asking this question. Here, is this clear? What the question? So this guy is familiar with these decision problems that we just listed over here, okay? This guy is, when this guy is saying, the CEO says, I know all this stuff. I know the decision problems that exist, and you guys are familiar with the rest of the problems also. We have gone through all of these things. Like in the case of buy sell, we saw that when we were trading options, there were some extra points that come up, extra decision problems that come up, which don't come up when you're trading spot. Okay, but when you're trading options, you have to decide on strike price, you have to decide on expiry, you have to decide on whether you're buying or selling a call or a put. Okay, and then as Saloni pointed out, we have to also decide exercise style. That's another point that you have to decide, right? I don't know whether Saloni or Tanya pointed out this. You did. Okay. So, so exercise style is another. So all these decisions you have to take, these are additional problems that come up when you're trading in options. All of these are decision problems. Is this clear? You understand?
Yes, sir.
These are all decision problems. Okay. Now, in the case of this, we have not discussed explicitly with you, but you can see that in the case of futures, forwards, and swaps, you don't have so many extra decision problems, but you do have the extra problem of expiry. Because remember, futures contracts, as just as an example, okay, if somebody tells you just buy crude oil futures, that's not good enough. Because when you look at crude oil futures, if you just look at crude oil futures and go there, you'll see. On price quotes, if you go to price quotes, you'll see that crude oil futures are available for many different maturities, right? So the question is, when you tell me to buy crude oil futures, which month do you want me to buy? Which contract month do you want me to buy? That question will arise. Yes? Okay, so that's another decision problem that you have in the case of futures, and it's the same for forwards, futures, and swaps. Okay, both types of swaps, FX swaps and capital market swaps, which we hopefully will have time to discuss. So this is what we are saying. So what the CEO is saying here is that I know all this stuff. Okay, I know all the problems that come up when you're managing a pass, when you're managing an active risk book, that is a speculator book, right? I know all these problems. Now my question is, the CEO is asking the treasurer, do these change, or do the solutions to these problems change in any way when you're managing a hedge portfolio? That is, this is the question that he has, that how these decision problems might apply, okay, in managing the hedge portfolio, right? So he's referring to the decision problems that we have already discussed for the managing for managing an active risk book, a spec book. Now he's asking, do these same problems apply in managing the hedge portfolio? Remember, your problem here is to manage the hedge portfolio because you can't touch the underlying positions, right? Your job is really to manage. Your decision problems are all focused on managing the hedge portfolio, constructing and managing the hedge portfolio. So let's look at these problems and see what happens to the first three problems. Well, let's go first one by one. Okay, actually we should put markets first, maybe that will decide, but anyway, we'll go we'll proceed in this way. So let's take the first one, let's take the second one first. Do you have it, how do you solve, do you have a further decision problem, like when you're starting on a speculative when you're starting your speculative trading projects? Okay, you had, well, I gave you certain restrictions, okay, but if I had not given you restrictions, you could have done anything. But in this case, what happens to markets? Can you independently choose your markets when running the hedge portfolio? No, because your markets are pretty much determined by what's on the underlying Your markets are all, what markets you're going to focus on. Remember when you went through the exercise of coming up with the KRFs? When you are identifying the KRFs itself, you are already finding out what markets exist, what kind of KRFs exist on the underlying as far as the underlying position portfolio is concerned. Okay, is this clear? All right. So that decision about markets is automatically solved. What we are trying to understand here, the question that the CEO is asking is that which problems are automatically solved and which problems have to be actively solved. Actively solved means in the way that you did it in your speculative trading projects, that you actively chose, you decided to buy an Amazon put, and then you actively chose the particular maturity, the expiry date, and you chose the strike price. Okay, nobody did it for you. You had to do it yourself. But automatically solved means you don't have to do that. You don't have to solve the problem because it's already solved automatically. So in this case, you can see that the question of markets is automatically solved. Is that clear? Markets question is automatically solved because you can already see the KRF markets on the balance sheet that you're managing. Is everyone clear about this? So this question is automatically solved. Okay, Hardik, sit up. Don't do this, bend your neck here and there. Sit up and look straight. Okay, right. Now, so the markets question is automatically solved. So if the markets question is solved, what happens to the asset class question? That is also solved, because if it's crude oil is one of the markets, then the asset class is going to be commodities. Okay, in the case of dollar yen, if that is one of the KRF markets is dollar yen, then the asset class is currencies, right? So this is how the asset class also gets automatically solved from the markets. In fact, when you choose the markets first, the asset class is automatically solved, right? Because we know what, like, you have this kind of thing in Finviz, you get a nice display. We can stop this. You can see all these futures, right? So if one of your markets is orange juice, then the asset class is, this will go into commodities. Okay, so this will basically go into commodities. If this is this is all commodities, if this is one of your markets, then what is the asset class? What is Russell 2000? Yeah, that's you. Me, you're not watching enough US markets TV, business TV. So Russell 2000 is a stock market index. It's an index of small cap companies. Okay, so these indices in the US are all different. The Dow has only 30 stocks. Okay, it's a very narrow index, but there's large cap companies. The S&P 500 is a value weighted index. It's a broad large cap index. The Nasdaq 100 is technology, largely technology focused. Okay, and then the Russell 2000 is a small cap index, 2000 small cap companies in the US. Right, so they're all different. So if you chart this, you see the Russell 2000 chart. Now there may not be much difference because the market is so strong that everything is pretty much moving together. But sometimes on the long term charts, you can see differences between the Russell 2000 and the S&P 500. This just shows me that you're not watching enough business television, because I've told you to focus on the US market because it's much more developed and you get to see what a developed market looks like. So you learn a lot more. And you will see lots of discussions about Russell is lagging the S&P or the Russell is leading the S&P, and that tells you, because the S&P is a large cap index, large to mid cap index, whereas the Russell is a small cap index. So there are very different types of companies, right? So anyway, so this is all. So what is this? What will be the asset class? What will be the asset class for this? Equity, right? So the Nikkei 225 is what index? Which country's stock index?
Japan.
Okay. So Japan is actually, the Nikkei 225 is the more famous index. You also have the Topix, okay, which is less famous, but the Nikkei is actually an unweighted index and it's more well known, more widely followed. All of these are actually equities. This is also related to equities because it's an equity options eyeball index. All right. So you can see here that when you choose the markets, as soon as you choose the market, the asset class is automatically chosen, is already determined, right? So that's why there's a case for probably putting the asset class first, I mean the markets first, but we have just done it this way. Okay, so instrument, now here, what about instrument? So here what we can do is, I've got a second law. So this is the original statement of the problem. I don't want to disturb it. Okay, managing an investment fund. I want to put this in bold. So this is the original set of problems that apply to what happened. Somebody banged on the door. Okay, be quiet now, one sec. So we have looked at now the same thing. I've repeated this here because we are going to now write up some stuff over here. Okay, refer to the Magma resources balance sheet, which means basically that now we are talking about the same decision problem and we're going to write down how they get solved, okay, automatically or actively. Okay, so auto or active, that's what we're going to write. So for this one we have already determined this is auto. Yes, this one is also auto. Okay, we'll just ignore that. Okay, all right. Okay, so now what about instruments? What about instruments? Is my question clear? Because in trading, in managing a speculative risk book, you can you also have to take a decision about instruments. Because ordinarily, if you are, let's say, running a speculative currency fund, okay, even when you've defined the asset class and maybe you've defined even the markets, when you're running a speculative currency fund, you have to take decisions about, do I trade spot currencies like this, like say this one, dollar yen, if one of your markets is dollar yen, right? And then your decision, you still have to decide about the instrument, because you have to decide whether should I trade, like, do I trade spot currencies or do I trade currency futures? Those are two different instruments, right? Or you could trade dollar yen options, just like I forced you to trade US equity options without touching US equities, the cash markets. You could also decide to trade dollar yen options only. Nothing can stop you from doing that. That's a choice, right? So all these are different instruments. You can choose if you have a view on dollar yen, right? If you have a view on dollar yen, which we... All right. So if you have a view here, is this the one making the noise? Why don't I just switch it off?
Yes, sir.
But we don't know whether this is making the noise. Where is the switch off?
It's not.
Or we can put the volume to zero.
Let's sit for 5 seconds.
Or we'll put the volume to zero. Okay, all right. Okay, guys, let's focus on this. So here you have dollar yen. We'll get another ad on this. Okay, so if you have a view on dollar yen, you can implement that view in various ways. You can implement that view by trading in spot. You can implement that view by trading in Garvit, what is the problem? If you want to sleep, just sleep with your head on the desk. Okay, so if you have a view on dollar yen, one sec. If you have a view on dollar yen, you can implement it in various ways. You can buy, let's say you're very bullish, I can buy call options, I can sell put options if I want to, right? Or I can go long futures. In this case I would be selling. If I'm bullish on dollar yen, this is directly relevant to your project. This kind of thinking is directly relevant to your project. If you are bullish, you may not actually do this, okay? But let's say if I'm bearish on dollar yen, let's change the view. Let's say I'm bearish on dollar yen. I can either buy put options, or I can sell call options, or I can come up with any number of option strategies, which you can read about on the CME options book, that 25 strategies that I've given you. Okay, so or you can do that, or you can actually go short the spot dollar yen if you're bearish on dollar yen. Okay, and what would you do if you are trading yen futures, if your view on dollar yen is bearish? What would you do? That is, if you expect specifically the chart here to drop, what would you do on the futures contract? Would you buy or sell? Yes, Srishti, is the question clear? If the view is dollar on dollar yen, I've told you to take the views always with respect to dollar yen. Okay, so if your view on dollar yen is bearish, okay, that is, expect the chart to drop like this, come back to 105, etc. In that case, how would you act with respect if you wanted to implement that view using yen futures contracts, yen currency futures contracts? What would you do with respect to the futures contract? Would you sell or would you buy? Is my question clear now? Yeah. Yes. Don't prompt her. Tell her, let her answer.
Sell.
You would sell in currency futures. Okay, what happened? Who else? Adarsh, what will you do? Buy or sell? Is my question clear?
Yes, sir.
Your view on dollar yen is bearish. So on yen futures, are you going to, when you, but you're forced to trade. I'm not letting you trade spot dollar yen. I'm not letting you trade dollar yen options. I'm forcing you to trade only yen currency futures on the CME. Okay. Now in this case, what will you do? Be quiet here. Nobody else should talk. You will buy yen futures. Okay. So who is right? Gail will tell us who is right. Adarsh wants to buy and Srishti wants to sell. Who is right? Not clear? What about Ganotra? Who is right? Buy. Okay, so you are siding with Adarsh. Okay, so the right answer is that Adarsh and Ganotra are correct. You will have to buy, because remember, in this yen futures contract, what is the base asset or the base currency?
Yen.
Okay, the yen futures contract is structured in such a way that yen is the base currency. Okay, so if you buy, that means you are expecting this to rise. You are expecting the yen to rise in value. You expect the base asset to rise. Okay, and the yen to rise in value, which means the yen will rise in value and the dollar will depreciate, right? And if you look back at the chart, when the chart drops from here to here, what is happening to the dollar? Is it depreciating or appreciating?
Depreciating.
It is losing value, because now $1 will only buy 105 yen, not 109.30. Yes, clear. So based on your view, so this is why I've done it deliberately like this, and this is the way you would anyway have to do it in real life. If you are ever trading, if you are ever using yen futures on the hedge book, okay, in that case you would still have to take your views on the spot dollar yen. So there's a little bit of complication involved, and that would make your training tougher, so it'll be better for you, right? So you will take your views based on dollar yen, but if you have a bearish view, and you would therefore need to hedge, okay, because if the yen appreciates, what will happen to your underlying, what will happen to your net worth?
Loss.
Through the movement, the net worth will go down. We have to reduce this a little bit, I think. Yeah, if the dollar yen drops, then the net worth will go down. We've already gone through this exercise. You can see it once again, but we'll not waste our time doing it once again. But the point here I was trying to illustrate is that you can see everybody is not 100% clear about this. Srishti, you're not paying much attention in class. That's one of the reasons why you're not clear. Most of the time you're not paying attention. So therefore, so is this clear to everyone now? You form the view on the dollar yen and this. So the what I'm trying to show you is that there is a choice to be made about instruments. When running a hedge book, it is your choice to decide which instrument you want to use. If you have, as I said, if you have a bearish view on dollar yen, simple way to use it, use options to implement the view, buy put options. Okay. And if you could also go, in this case, if you are using the yen currency futures, you would buy the yen currency futures, because that will protect you when the dollar yen drops. The yen will rise in value, but because you've already bought it on the hedge book will make a profit, and that will offset your losses on the underlying position. Yes, everyone's clear? All right. So there is a choice to be made. So what we write, any problems, please ask. Okay. So what do we write here? This will become instrument choice is active. It's not auto. Instrument choice is not automatic. Choice of instrument is something that is made by the hedging team. I'll just come to you. Is this clear to everyone? You are not forced to use one. In this particular project, I'm forcing you to use futures contracts. But in real life, we have to study it as how, based on how it will actually happen in real life. Okay. In this particular project, because I want to just force you to trade futures contracts, because futures we've not covered. We've covered options previously, but we have not covered futures. So this forces you to, because I want to make you learn about futures contracts. So that's why I'm forcing you to trade everything through futures. But in the in real life, this will not happen. Okay. In real life, you will have a choice as a hedging team. Again, that depends on the company policy. The company policy is such that they don't want to use futures for some reason, but that's a little unusual. Okay, normally they would leave the discretion as to instrument to the hedging team. They may put some liquidity constraints, but they will generally leave the choice of instrument to the hedging team. So this is to be written as active. Is this clear? Is everyone following what we are doing? We are taking the same decision problems from the spec book, and we are trying to see how the solutions to the active to these same decision problems change when you're running a hedge portfolio to offset the risks on a passive risk book. Yes? Okay. Yes, what's your question, Garvit?
Sir, first question was that if we are buying the yen futures, so we have to pay dollars and then we'll be getting yen. That's the point.
No, I'm not able to follow you. But see, yen, here what we're doing is, this is dollar yen.
Yes.
So the dollar is the base asset. When you're trading in spot dollar yen,
yes.
Okay, well, the dollar yen exchange rate,
it's
the spot market trades, it's an OTC market, it trades on with dollar as the base currency. This is just a convention.
Yes, sir.
There's not no the science behind it. It's a convention, okay? Just like in India, we drive on the left-hand side of the road. There's no big science behind it. You could have also driven on the right side. Okay. Now, as far as yen futures are concerned, the logic is reversed. I mean, the system is reversed. So the yen futures contracts on the CME are designed in such a way that the yen is the base asset. Okay, so the base currency, the yen, and the dollar is the terms currency. So in both cases, we would treat this as the same market, but a little variation, because the same market, because the assets are the same. Right, but the arrangement is a little bit different because of the structure of the futures contract. This is clear? Okay, yeah. Okay, so we are following the decision problems. Okay, so we discover that this is auto and this is active. Okay, now let's come to the next problem, and we are not going to write this anymore because this is for our, that was meant for our active risk book. Okay, next one is buy sell. We're not going to write this also here because we need to have space for writing either auto or active. Now, as far as the buy sell decision is concerned, obviously when we come to each of these decisions, we assume that the prior decisions have already been made. Okay, when we would, that's for the same thing that we did when we considered it for a spec book, that when we came to the question of buy sell, we assumed that these decisions had already been made. Okay, and then we just figure out how to decide this. Now the question is, you have already decided, you know what the KRF markets are. Okay, these are your KRF markets, and you have already decided that you're going to hedge everything you've chosen. So markets will determine the asset class, and then the instrument also has been determined. You have chosen futures. Okay, I forced you, but we assume that you have chosen futures. So those decisions have already been made. Now the question is, when running, now these decision problem questions relate to the running of the hedge portfolio, remember, because the underlying positions you can't touch. So your activity is only confined to the hedge portfolio, the construction and the management of the hedge portfolio, right? So when we are asking this question of should I buy or should I sell on the hedge side, on the hedge portfolio, what is this problem here? Is this automatically solved, or is it is this something that you have to actively sell? Yes, everyone is clear, it's automatically solved, because if you looked at when we discussed the golden rule of hedging and things like that, when I look at, let's say, if I look at this crude oil chart and I'm very bullish, I don't have the, if I'm very bullish but my underlying position is long, in this case my decision is what?
Not to do anything.
My decision becomes not do nothing. It's not I can't afford to buy, because I will then violate the golden rule of hedging, because my underlying position is already 25,000 long. Okay, so if I buy more contracts now, I will go further long and I'll violate that rule, that any point of time the total position must remain between zero and the initial underlying position, which is 25k. So my total position can't go beyond 25k. Is this clear? And you understand the logic and the philosophy that come, the philosophy that lies behind that kind of a rule is that the objective of hedging is always to reduce risk. You can always ask me, why did you come up with this kind of rule? I don't need any of these rules. But the idea, the reason you need this rule is because the objective of hedging, the whole philosophical underpinning, which sets the context for hedging, is that the idea is to reduce risk and bring certainty to cash flows. And the certainty to cash flows comes from the fact that you lock in the price. Remember, we talked about how you can lock in the net realization or the net valuation of the asset liability items. Because once you hedge, no matter what happens to the market, up or down, that hedging price is locked in. You saw that, right? Remember, for the effective net price is locked in. On a net basis, the hedging price is locked in. So that's how hedging brings certainty to cash flows. And that's the overarching objective of hedging. When you read these risk management disasters in the Hull book, Okay, you will find that these disasters happened because people were not following these kinds of, most of the time they happened because people were not following these strict guidelines. Okay, certainly I know that the JP Morgan case happened because of this. I mean, if they had followed this rule, this would not have happened in the JP Morgan case. The London Whale disaster. Okay, so now you see one important decision, which is the buy-sell decision, which is pretty much a lot of finance theory focuses on how to do the buy-sell, take the buy-sell decision. So this problem, as you can see, is automatically solved. Because if your underlying position is long and you studied the KRF markets, one of the KRF markets is crude oil, and you know the underlying position in crude oil. So here you already know that you are always going to be looking to sell. When it comes to the hedge portfolio, again, we are discussing with a simple case of static hedging programs, okay, because dynamic hedging programs are slightly more complicated, so we're not going to initially to understand the process, we will just discuss static hedging program. So you already know that the question of buy or sell has already been decided, because if your underlying position is long, then on the hedge portfolio, you're only going to be a seller. Okay, so it's only a question of when you're going to sell. So you take a view on the markets, and if the market, your underlying position is long and the market view is very bullish, in that case, what you do is you do nothing. Okay, so remember when we studied, when I think I taught you this in business law, that in the law, as far as the law is concerned, act is also, when you say act, means act of stealing, okay, or act of committing murder. In the law, in the Indian Penal Code and other aspects of the law, act also includes lack of action. The idea of act includes lack of action. So in that case, I'm just reminded of that as a way of jumping to that subject. But the point is, here you don't do anything. Okay, here you don't do anything. Okay, because your view is bullish and the underlying position is long, so you can't do anything. So pretty much your question of whether in this market you're always going to be a seller. So your buy sell decision is already taken, is automatically solved. Is this clear? Yes, everyone is clear about this. Okay, so against this we are going to write auto, right? Buy sell is auto, right? Now this, what we are going to do is, these are actually extra decision problems that you will have. These problems will remain, okay? To some extent they will remain, to some extent they are auto, but they are largely going to be actively decided. Okay, I'm not going to complicate the discussion by essentially you can see that you do have certain amount of choice. Certainly what we are going to do is I'll just discuss it for futures and I'll leave it for options. Essentially what will happen is that you will have these decisions will have to be actively solved, these decision problems. Okay, so I'm going to just write that and I'll explain to you why. Because you do have, it is to some extent, there is some element of automatic decision making in this, automatic decisions in this, but there is still a lot of discretion. So I would write, for the purposes of discussing a case where you're learning how to manage a hedge book, we will treat it as active. Okay, so let's look at the question of, is it too tightly bunched together? Are you finding it difficult to follow?
No,
okay, I've kept it deliberately like this so we can see everything in one view. Okay, line spacing is okay. Yeah.
But we don't have to take any views and options.
No, but we are, yeah, you're in this particular project, you're trading only on options, only on futures, okay, only using futures. But when we are discussing, remember the objective of this case is to teach you, to give you an overall framework for corporate treasury risk management. Okay, what do you do when you have to manage a hedge book? And as we discussed yesterday, the same principles of hedging can also be applied to speculative books when you're in a situation where for some, like a long only asset manager who's benchmarking against an index, okay, he doesn't really want to surrender his long positions, but he just wants to hedge because he's very scared that the market will drop. So that, again, the same hedging framework comes into play. The same kind of hedging framework comes into play in the active risk book as well. So we are trying to cover the theoretical foundation for hedging. So that's why we are discussing all these things comprehensively. Okay, so essentially that's why I said the actual decision I will I'll just discuss with the why it's active, why am I writing it as active. Okay, so therefore I'm discussing that only with respect to futures, and it will apply to forwards and swaps also. But even in the case of options, I'm going to write active because you do have a lot of flexibility in deciding all this. You will have that. I'm not going to go into the details of that. Okay, so these decision problems essentially three with options also will be actively sold. You will have the flexibility to decide expiry, strike price, call, put. Now this will be, yeah, you can, if you are going to decide buy or sell, you will have some flexibility. Even in this you can decide, because there are complex strategies that you can put up. So we'll put all these things down as actively sold, okay, for options. We're not going to discuss it in detail. Let's discuss futures. Why am I saying futures expiry is active? Okay. Yes? Yeah, I understand why you're saying auto, but remember, what am I saying is active? I'm not saying that the buy sell decision is active. Okay, so if your underlying position in crude oil is long, if your underlying position in crude oil is long, you already know that your buy sell decision is automatically solved. It has to be sell. Okay, now you're going to come to that next decision, which is you only have discretion with respect to the timing of the sell. Right now you're not going to sell because your view is that the market is very bullish. So it would be stupid to sell at $61.22 when you think this is going to $73. Okay, you are better off selling at $73. So that's why you're not selling. So you're only basically, you're exercising your discretion with respect to the timing of the sell. Okay, which we will see in one of the later decision problems. But now the question is, I'll show you why futures expiry are driven as an active decision problem. Let's look at this distribution. Okay, now in practice what will happen, now I've simplified things on this balance sheet a little bit. Okay, so let's just look at these. I really want to get this masthead out of the way so I can show more months, contract months. But anyway, let's look at this. So in practice what I have done is this. Okay, I've given you 25,000. Let's just continue to focus on the crude oil position. Okay, so I've given you 25,000 barrels as the underlying position. Okay, so now here what is happening is that you can also be hedging future production. Remember when the airlines hedge, like I gave you the example of Ryanair. Ryanair regularly hedges crude oil, jet fuel purchases out to 5 years. So that 5 years purchase, they obviously haven't bought everything, you know, I mean, they're not going to buy this stuff and hold it in inventory for 5 years. They're going to buy it later. But because 5 years price movement can be dramatic, so they want to buy it now and, you know, cover the risk. So what happens? Let me just show you what I mean by this. We'll just make this into US oil. Okay, so here, so I've shown you 25,000 as spot production. So to simplify the situation, I have treated it as this is already inventory that is on the books. Okay, now in practice when you have when you are hedging, what will happen is there'll be a greater level of detail. What will happen is that the sales team will actually tell you that, we are going to just use this briefly to do the discussion. Okay, so in the case of oil, okay, we're just doing this for oil. So the sales team will tell you that, and let's say they're projecting in Jan, okay, in Feb, and if we do Jan Feb, then let's say, right, so they may come up with this, and then they might say that here you are going to get 15 additional tons, then you know, 25 60 75, okay, maybe 35, and so on and so forth. Let me just take these two. We will not overcomplicate things. The point is basically that in practice what you will get is just like Ryanair is hedging future oil purchases. Okay, so you can even think of this as, so when an airline knows that it's going to be in business, so even 2 years down the line, it will be buying crude oil, it will be buying jet fuel, right? So they can project their purchases 2-3 years out, month by month. They can project that every month we are going to be buying maybe whatever, 10,000 liters or whatever they use, whatever unit they use to measure jet fuel. Okay, so they can project that. Can you see that? So we can project here like this, 10,000 liters, 25,000 liters, 60,000 liters we are going to buy in each of these future months, right? So essentially what will happen is, you may actually, sometimes there are two few options that you have. There are two options that you have actually, that, no, we need to go to the crude oil futures. Okay, that doesn't matter, let it be. Okay, all right, here, so when you see crude oil futures, okay, you can see that all these months exist. Okay, so let's now see that, let's assume that these are Yeah, so similarly, the production side also, on the production side here, you're running a Magma as an exploration company. They can project that this much oil is going to be available. Finished goods inventory is going to come on board. In March, we are going to get 60,000 liters. We're going to get 60,000 barrels. Okay. In April, we are going to get 75,000 barrels is going to come on board. So basically, what they are projecting is how your unhedged inventory position is going to build up. Are you following? They can project just like an airline, like Ryanair can project its future consumption. Similarly, an exploration company can also project its future production based on some reasonable base patterns, right? Some underlying core production patterns. Okay, you can project something. You won't get it exactly right. That's why you'll undershoot. If you think actually you're going to produce 900, if you're going to produce 90,000 barrels, you will probably say projecting for the hedge team, you will project only 70,000. So at least 70,000 is going to come on board definitely. Okay, it may vary a little bit from 90,000. So you undershoot and project when you're producing. Okay, are you following this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so one of the choices that a hedge team has is that you are going to essentially be looking at this kind of projections from the production. So the hedge team has to coordinate both with the sales team, because the sales team, the effect of the sales team is that these numbers are going to run down as a result of the activities of the sales team. These numbers are going to run down, right? Because they are going to be continuously selling as well, because the business goes on. So the sales team may actually in December itself, they may sell some crude oil. They may sell 30,000 barrels to Korea. Somebody saying that, okay, we know that if Korea wants April delivery for 30,000 barrels, they may sell 30,000 barrels to Korea, knowing that this is going to come on board, because they have a continuous production running. Are you following? So this the activities of the sales team is, it will affect, it will end up leading to the reduction of these numbers. Is everyone following? The sales team will end up reducing these numbers because they are always selling. So these are the unhedged inventory numbers. Okay, let's put this as unhedged inventory. We are having this discussion because you are actually concerned really with unhedged inventory, not really the accountant's idea of inventory. You are concerned with unhedged inventory. Maybe we can take this a little bit lower down, not to clutter up the balance sheet. Is everyone following this idea? That as a hedging team, your balance sheet actually is a slightly different type of balance sheet. You're dealing with unhedged inventory. Okay, so not the accountant's idea of inventory. And then the production side gives you certain numbers. So you're as a hedging team, you have to be talking to all parts of the company. You have to talk to the production side, and they will give you some estimates of how much is going to come on board in each month in the future, right? Because every business has to make projections. Remember, they're also making budgets, they're making sales projections, earnings projections. So part of the projection you will make is also this production, how much inventory is coming on board. Yes, so the production team gives you the numbers, the sales teams keeps on changing the numbers, because they will keep on selling here and there, and they will keep on updating you. These are the fresh numbers, so you'll have to keep on updating this figure. You have to keep on updating this figure because you're in touch with both the teams. And so then all the time you're looking at your net unhedged inventory figure, okay, which is this, in this case is 210. You're looking at the total. Okay, so to simplify your calculations and the management of the position, I have because this is the first time you're doing this kind of activity, so to simplify that, I have created the, that's why I said it's a stylized balance sheet. Okay, so I've created this kind of simplified case as if 25,000 barrels is sitting in spot inventory. It's already there sitting in ships or wherever, you know, or in a storage facility. It's a spot inventory, but in practice, you will have to look at the entire production plan, and you have to look at the sales plan also. Will also be updating the figures. Is everyone following here?
Yes.
You know how a business operates. This is how it operates. You can look at any business, even if you're running, you're manufacturing shoes. This will also be there in a shoe manufacturing business. The production team will tell you how much we are going to make, how many shoes we are going to make in a month. Then the sales team will also be trying to sell those shoes, right? So the same thing. Okay, any business has this kind of a pattern. So as a hedging team, you have to be in touch with both the production side and the sales side to be constantly updated on what is the net unhedged inventory. Is this clear? This 210, and that's what you're managing. That's your initial underlying position. As far as you're concerned, that golden rule of hedging, not going beyond total position, not going beyond zero, and initial underlying position. That initial underlying position is basically this equivalent of the 210 number. Is this clear? Okay, so now you see all these thing numbers are coming up, right? Now you have two choices. Why did I say expiry? We are discussing that same problem. Why is expiry when you're hedging with futures? Why is expiry? Why have I written active, not automatic? Why did I write active, not automatic? We are discussing the case of futures. Why have I written active, not automatic? Why did I say that? Because you have a choice. You have two ways to do it. Where are productions? We have Jan, Feb, March, April, May. Do we have contracts? Okay, there's no contract for Jan. Okay, so that's very close, so that we can ignore that. Okay, now Feb here you have Feb, March, April, May. Okay, now you have a choice. You can sell the, if you want to go, let's say assume that first you have to start with a view. Let's say that at this point, because we are going to assume we are going to the expiry decision, okay, so we are going to assume that the buy sell is already solved, because the buy sell is the prior decision. So when we are trying to analyze how we solve a particular problem, we always assume that the previous problems are all already solved, and then only we come to this, because otherwise it becomes difficult to discuss, right? So in this case, we assume that you have already decided to sell at this point itself. Okay, so you've now got, your view is that the market is toppish at this point. Now the market is likely to drop straight back to 50. So you better hedge your entire position, right? So now in this case, we are discussing this example of your position is 210 contracts. Okay, let's assume your, in this case, example is 210 contracts, because this is a sum of all these positions. So now you have a choice. You can actually Jan, Feb, March, April, May, right? So Jan is very close, so you can take that risk. Feb, March, April, May. Now you have a choice. You could actually decide to, because remember you also have to look at liquidity. Okay, here they have not shown the volume figures. Yeah, you can see the volume figure. Can you see a difference in the volumes? Because you're also concerned with liquidity, because liquidity will affect bid offer spreads. Because if you're running an active hedging program, a dynamic hedging program, you may be getting in and out several times. Remember, liquidity affect, you understand liquidity, right?
Yes, sir.
Whenever you can sell, buy or sell huge amounts without moving the price. So here you can see the crude oil price. Okay, Jan basically is already, it's not trading actively anymore, because it's already the last trading date must have already gone. Okay, so here you can see how tight the bid offer spread even in Asian time, because this is actually a North American contract. So even in Asian time, when even London has not opened, Zurich maybe also not open, but this is the tight bid offer spread that you see. So if the market is not liquid, what will happen is, and the volume is the one of the important indicators of liquidity. Okay, so you can see here that volume is the volume same for all contracts? April, May, June, Feb, March, April, May, is the volume same for all? No, right? So you can see that the Feb contract is the most liquid, right? So you have two choices as a hedging team. This is why expiry is written as solution to expiry is active, not automatic. Because you could say, if you are always going to do Jan, Feb, April, one option you have is that you hedge against the specific months. So you have Jan, Feb, March, April, May. So whatever is the production for May, whatever is the production for May, you have 35,000. So you sell 35 contracts in May right now. Okay, then you look at the figure for April, then you sell that amount. What is the figure for April? 75 contracts. So in April you sell 75. Are you following this? These are all different contracts. Okay, at any point of time you can set up in your futures, in your IB display itself, you can set up multiple month contracts. Okay, you can just, when you are setting up the ticker, it will give you the option which month do you want. Because in futures contracts, you always have to specify the expiry, because otherwise the question is not, your statement is not complete. If you just say, I want to please sell some crude oil futures for me, then the next question will come is, which month? because there are different months, contracts are trading for different months, different contracts. So one of the ways you can do this, okay, which would basically look like automatic solution, okay, but that is, you take look at the figure for May. May production is supposed to be 35k, 35 contracts, therefore each contract is 1k. So therefore in May you sell 35 over here. May is 35, yeah. May you sell 35. Okay, we are assuming here you don't see bid and offer, but we assume that this is a choice price. So you sell 35 contracts at 60.07. Is this clear? This is assuming that your view on the market is such that the market is about to crash right now. I better hedge everything right now. Is this clear? That decision has to be taken. The timing to sell decision has been taken. Now we are trying to see why expiry is an actively solved problem. So one option is you just look at the market, the particular expiries. Then March you have 60k, so you sell 60k against this. Yes, are you following? Okay, then April, whatever you had, you sold against April. Then Feb you have 25, so you sell 25 in Feb against Feb. Okay, now here this would seem like it's automatic because it's driven by the production plan forecast given by the production team. It seems like it's automatic, okay, but the reason I've not put this as automatic, but why the larger decision is given as actively solved, because you do have a choice. You do have a choice as the hedging team, and that is that because sometimes these projections, remember, for instance, if you remember the actual case of Ryanair, they're hedging out to 5 years. This is just 2020. Okay, if you look down, crude oil prices go up very far out. You can see how far out they go. So now if you think of the other side, if you're looking at Ryanair, you're looking at probably they're hedging up to 2025 purchases. They are hedging even 2025 purchases because they're hedging out 5 years, right? So one of the things you notice is that there's not much volume in the FAR contracts. Of course, this is not a good time to look at it. You have to really look at it in the US time, because this is a US contract. If you see in US time, but even there you'll see that 2025 contract volume is not going to be as high as your Feb 2020 volume. Are you following? Okay, so therefore one of the things that hedging teams very often do is that they will do what is basically this expression is called stack and roll. So I'm going to write it here. Okay, I'm going to write it, we should write it against this. Where is my, okay, it's here. Okay, so this is active. Why is this active? Because I'm going to put an asterisk here. Have you guys read Asterix comics? No, nobody has read Asterix comics. Okay, that's a different spelling slightly. Okay, but anyway, so let me clarify the asterisk here. So then we'll talk about stack and roll. Okay, stack, you know what stack is? Stack is if I just pile up everything on top, I stack them together. That's what stacking is. Okay, so I take a bunch of stacking means you take a bunch of items and you stack them all together. Okay, so stack and roll, you know, roll means roll is actually for rollover. Okay, so now one sec, let's understand what this means. Okay, what is the other choice that you have? First you understand this choice and then I'll just give you a write-up on this, and I'll give you maybe there's actually a famous risk management disaster associated with this. So in this case, what you're going to do is, if you assume that you have exposures running up to May, okay, of 2020, and then for the sake of argument we are going to assume that even in May 2020 the volumes are very low. Okay, so the only liquid contract is really the Feb contract. Okay, so we can actually change this a little bit and make this Jan disappear. The only liquid contract is the Feb contract. We can put in a June also and make this say 45, but this has to be changed. Okay, yeah, it was, yeah, now it's okay. So now is everyone following what is happening? So we have all these projected exposures, okay, unhedged inventory. Now ideally I would do this, but if I see that the volumes are very, very high in Feb and March, April, May, June, the volumes are very thin. Okay, volumes are, just for the sake of argument, because I don't want to construct a 5 year set of rows for 5 years. Let's assume for the sake of argument that Feb, March, April, May and June, the volumes are very low. Okay, and the only high volume is in Feb. Yes, okay, for the sake of argument. In this case, what you might do is you might do a stack and roll, that you might decide that entire 2240K I'm going to sell for Feb. Follow the logic here, okay? Entire 240K I sell for Feb, okay? So I sell 240K in Feb. Now, but actually the Fed exposure is only 25, okay? So what I'm going to do is, once the Feb exposure runs off, because you will have to sell it at some point, okay? So once the Feb exposure runs off, then what happens is, I am left with only, so, 215, okay? I'm left with only this. If we take, now this has to be written in a, this should be $19. Where are the dollars? Okay, see, I'm so poor that I can't see the dollars. Okay, all right, okay, 215. Okay, now let's, all right, now you see the figures. Okay, now what you're going to do is, in how this is how stack and roll works. Okay, this is how stack and roll works. We can put that expression here, stack and rollover, we can put it here as well. Don't actually say rollover, I've said rollover, but the expression that people use in the industry is stack and roll. Let's put it this way. Okay, stack and roll, right? Okay, so the way it works is, you have a total exposure of 240. Now you're not able to ideally sell against the particular months, okay, because your contract volume is high only in the near month. So what you do is, you stack the total exposure. This is the stacking part of it. This is the stacking part of it. Okay. Now, what will you do? Now we're going to roll over at each point of time only to the next month. Okay. So next month is, yeah, here we have March, April, May, we have all of them. Okay, good. So we have here also Feb, March, April, May. Okay, so what we're going to do is, at this point, what I've decided, you need to have a, that you can keep on changing from each rollover depending on the liquidity, but we are going to assume that each point when you're rolling over, you will only roll to the next month, because you're going to assume that always the highest volume is going to be in the front month. This is called the front month. In this situation, this Feb is called the front month. When Feb rolls off and then March is only trading, the March is the earliest contract trading, that will be called the front month. These are all futures terms that we use in the futures markets. Okay, so what we are going to do now is, I think you'll get the scheme. So initially I sell 240 contracts. Okay, in February 25 rolls off. Okay, so now I have, now my remaining unhedged position is 215. Okay, so what am I going to do? I'm already short. So Feb, this I'm going to write as near month, and now I'm going to write it as far month. Remember, this should remind you of the terminology that we used for discussing the repo. Remember, the two legs of the repo. Everybody now forgotten what repo is. Okay. So two legs of the repo, we always said you should discuss them as near leg and far leg. Okay. Now, for any kind of transaction which has two legs, we should use this term. So we're going to use two, near month and far month. Now, what will I do? I've got, actually my position is 215 short, right? Because my underlying position is long. So initially I sold 240 contracts for Feb. Is everyone clear? Yes. Are you following? Yeah. I sold, my hedge transaction was a sale of 240 contracts for Feb. Okay, now Feb has rolled off, 225 has rolled off in Feb. Now I need to remain short 215 contracts. So what will I do? I will sell this. No, I will, what I'll have to do is, what I need to, see, think about the objective. The objective is, now let's go to that particular chart. The objective is, I have a 240 contract short position in Feb. Okay, now 25 is going off. I will be left with 215 contract position. I need to maintain. So objective, always be clear about the objective. Okay, this is very important in everything you do in life, because most of the time people are running around like headless chickens because they don't know what their objective is. Okay, so always be clear about the objective. What is your objective? Your objective is to maintain, at the, as February rolls off, your objective is to maintain a 215 contract short position in the next active month, which is March. Yeah, March is the next month. Yes, clear? That's your objective. And what is, where are you now? Okay, where are you now? Here. You are here now. Okay, you are right now. Your position is short 215 contracts in March, in Feb. Right now, if with this rolls off, okay, so what will happen is you have to basically create in the far month, you have to create a position of minus 215. All right, so then for what you're going to do is, but you're right now, your position you need to create in the case of this, you need to create a short position of 215 contracts in March, in the March contract. Are you following? Yes, that's your objective. And what is your current situation? You're short. As 25 contracts roll off, you are short 215 contracts in Feb. So what you have to do is you have to cancel. You don't want to have any more remaining contract in Feb because Feb is dying out. Okay, so your objective is to cancel out the short position of 215 in Feb and create a short position of 215 in March. So what you will do is basically you will do a purchase of 215 in March. In Feb you will buy for, so you are short 240 contracts already in Feb.
Yes,
out of that 25 is rolling off. You can deliver, let's assume that we are delivering against the Feb contract. We already have this in inventory. We have 25 contracts, and so just imagine, so it's very clear the scheme. Remember, these are physical delivery contracts. Crude oil is physical delivery. Okay, it's not financially settled. So you are short 240 contracts. 25 contracts, you give notice to the exchange that I am going to deliver physical against this, because remember, you are short. You have the right to decide whether or not you want to deliver physical. Okay, and what is the first day on which you can do that? What is that date called?
Third week.
No, not like that. What is the technical term for that? The first day on which the which your book, there is a mistake in the book, I pointed out. The first day on which the holder of the short position can notify the exchange clearinghouse that he will be making physical delivery to satisfy his short position. What is the name? Something close, you are quite close. That is called the first position date. Okay?
Yes.
And the related term is first notice date, which is the first day on which the exchange can notify the buyer, the holder of a long position, that you are going to be delivered against. Okay, this is all there in your notes in futures. You better revise all this stuff. Okay, right. Next is, okay, so is this clear now? So 1 minute, just 1 minute. We'll finish this one. We still have 3 minutes. We still have 2 minutes. 1 minute. We are going to finish this. Understand this transaction of stack and roll. Okay. So what am I going to do? I have 240 contracts short against Feb. I am going to make physical delivery against 25 short.
Yes, sir.
So I only have to manage the 215 short balance. Okay. I still have 215 short in Feb, which I don't want. If I am short and I don't want it, I go long, equal amounts. So then what I do is I do one transaction, which these are actually connected transactions. Okay, that is, these are all connected transactions. That is, they're going to be like this. Okay, these are all connected transactions. That you are going to buy 215 contracts for Feb. You'll do one transaction. This is called a futures intermonth spread. Okay, so you're going to do a sell, a spread where you're going to sell, you're going to buy Feb and sell March, equal amount, just like a repo. This the units will remain the same. Okay, the price will change. So you will be now, if you make 25, you make physical delivery, your balance problem is 215, you're short in Feb, you don't want that short in Feb, so you buy it back, you buy 215 for Feb. Okay, and you sell 215 for March. Is this clear? Net result is Feb position is squared out and you are left with a 215 short position for March. Okay, in March you'll be left with a 215 short position. Is this clear? And then what will happen when the March comes, when March comes around, 60 will roll off, so you'll be left with 180. Then again you are going to do 180 plus and 180 minus to the next month. Okay, you understood the scheme?
Yes.
The idea is very clear. You have to make sure, always be clear about your objective. Where are you now and what is your objective? Okay, so therefore if you keep that in mind, then you'll be able to solve the problem. So this is called stack and roll. Now you have a choice as a hedging team. You have a choice to decide whether or not you're going to hedge into those specific months like this, or you want to stack and roll. Remember, there are two choices. You could have also hedged against those individual contracts.
Yes, sir.
Remember, I showed you the first choice.
Yes, sir.
See what your exposure in May, go and sell in May. See what is it in Jan, go and sell in Jan. Or you can stack and roll. That depends on how the liquidity is distributed. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you guys are dismissed, so Tarun can ask his question.
Excel.
Not Excel, spreadsheet. it's not Excel, it's spreadsheet.
So in the project, sir,
One question at a time.
Sir, we are short in March 215.
Yeah.
But when you roll off 60, then it will be 215 minus 60, you know?
1 minute. Right? Let me write this as a formula. And okay, we will write this as equal to this. And we will write this as, I can't even see, there are so many people here. I can't see my equal to sign. Equal to minus. Yes. All right. Okay. Why did this 205 come? There is some problem here.
That's what I'm saying. It should be cumulative. It's not cumulative.
Yeah. It should be cumulative. So
it should be.
Correct.
Minus 60.
Yeah.
Then
It should be. It should be actually. So this we have to maintain as. So now it should be not against that. It should be against.
This is 215.
Yeah. Against. It should be against. G 19.
We don't have to fix.
It's going to be G 19. Now it will make sense. Okay.
Yeah, now it's
now it makes sense.
Now
okay.
It's
now it makes sense. Okay.
Yeah,
so you understood this concept. So there is a very important concept to learn in futures hedging. There is a concept of stack and roll. And now you understand why. Why I said that the decision is. Why is the decision? Why am I saying that it is active? Not why is it active, not automatic?
Because you can choose to do.
Because you can choose to do. Yeah, you can choose to do stack and roll. Just like when you mix, if you have non-veg and you mix some veg in it, it's still called non-veg.
Yeah.
Because there's non-veg in it. So the fact that you have some kind of discretion automatically means that it is going to be called active because you have a choice. Just similarly in criminal law, when you have a, you know, there's a cognizable offense and a non-cognizable offense. You know what that is?
Yeah.
Cognizable offense is the one which basically for which your officer can arrest without a warrant. Okay. So if you have done certain things which constitute, which are made up of cognizable and non-cognizable offense, it is treated, the treatment of that case is basically like a cognizable offense case because that is more serious. So we go there. So that's why. So that this logic is clear why I have written active. It's a very important concept to understand how stack and roll work. Very simple actually, but still you have to be clear. None of this is nuclear physics, but these are new concepts and there's a lot of detail involved. So you have to make sure that you understand carefully at each step what is the requirement. Once you understand that, then you have cracked it for life. You'll never have to, you don't have to memorize it anymore. Yes? Yeah. No, actually you're not doing hedging in past, the statement is not correct. You are running a hedge portfolio because you are confronted or you're saddled with a passive risk book. So if you don't run your hedge portfolio, then all kinds of stuff can happen. The market can go up and down and you could end up losing a lot of money, right? So because you are confronted with a passive risk book, you are actually running a hedge portfolio. That is the right way to say it.
So we are running hedge portfolio. So hedging can be done, hedging can be done in two ways, static dynamic, right? In passive risk book, we are doing static hedge.
No,
static hedging.
No, one minute. Yeah, it can be, terms are a little bit confusing. No, what we are saying is that you have a passive risk book here, okay? You have a passive risk book. The question of running a hedge portfolio arises because you are confronted with a passive risk pool. You don't do anything, all kinds of stuff can happen, and even bad stuff can happen, right? Now, when you run a hedge portfolio, there are two philosophical approaches to running a hedge portfolio, which you can read in your notes. Okay, it's all explained in great detail. Okay, you can either run a hedge portfolio, there'll be a hedging program for which you need to have a policy or written down policy. So in that hedge risk management policy, where you can write down or you can decide whether you want to run the hedge portfolio as a static hedging program or a dynamic hedging program. Okay, that's a choice you have. That's a choice that every company is going to make for itself. Okay, so you can decide. So the static, we have discussed most of these things with respect to static hedging programs because it's simpler to understand. Because only one way, the movement is only one way. The hedge keeps getting the unhedged position, total position keeps getting reduced. Okay, so that's simpler to understand. Then once you have understood that, then you can think about dynamic hedging, where you take very intricate views on markets. Like you, at this point of time, I'm very bearish on crude oil. I think it's going to drop to 55. So at this point, I was already full. I go fully hedged. So I have 25 contracts long position underlying. I sell 25 contracts here in the hedge book. So my total position goes to zero. Then the market turns out, I turn out to be, my view turns out to be correct. Market drops to 55. Now I feel the market is going to turn around and go back to 70. So what I do is whatever I unhedged, whatever I hedged over here, I unhedge once again. So I buy back 25 contracts. So my total position once again goes to 25 plus. Earlier it was zero. Okay. Now again, why have I gone 25 plus? Because my view is the market is going straight up. If my view is correct, market shoots up to 70. Then once again, I sell, and at this point my view is that the market is going to now collapse to 60. Then I sell again 25. Again I sell 25 contracts, right? So therefore, then again the total position goes to net position will go to zero at this point. Okay, I've locked in my realization at 70. Then the market drops here at 60, and go on. I go on and on like this. Repeat the cycle. So, but this is a more risky approach, as I showed you earlier in one of the earlier videos, right? That so therefore. It is generally more prudent to run just a static program, but you can also run a dynamic program as long as you know what you're doing. You should be aware of the risks. That's what is required, really. That when you're doing something, you need to be aware of what are the risks of that kind of approach, and you should be ready for it, right? So you will be doing dynamic hedging. That you will be running a dynamic hedge program. Okay, I've given you that flexibility. But well, if you can, I mean, when you have the flexibility to run a dynamic hedging program, you can effectively behave as if you're running a static hedging program, because that is within your the flexibility given to you. But the reverse is not true. If I've given you permission to run only a static hedging program, then you can't run it like a dynamic hedging program. So it does, it's not symmetrical, right? Yeah, so but for the sake of the, I mean, so that I'm now encouraging you to take more and more precise views. You notice about these scenarios which we discuss, you notice how precise the views are, right? So that's what you should be doing as a markets professional. You have to take very precise views, and for which you need charts. Even if you're a fundamental analyst, you need charts, because you can point out the markers. Like, okay, I can point that this will come from here to here, and it'll go up to here. So it becomes easier to discuss, right? Yeah, clear?